Hey guys, welcome to the Lodcast number 36. Today we have a lot of fun topics to talk about, as well as a guest who is a famous, I would say this time around, famous YouTuber who does tech. He's got quite a storied past, and we'll get on into all that, as well as the topics we have for today. But first, let's catch up with everyone. I'll start with Matt again. Matt, once again, because this is the second time we're doing this, how's your week been?
I'm good. Been playing Deathloop. Pretty good so far. Only decent chunk in. If anyone wants to know my critique so far, is I feel like the game gives you a little too much in the beginning. The only way you could die is if you're just not looking at the ground, and then up there's a trip mine.
Yeah, pretty much. It's the game is too easy, I think.
That's my main criticism so far.
Yeah. So, yeah, that's Matt.
Yes. Great.
That's good. How have you been, Jay? We didn't have Jay in the last part. We were going to make a joke about it because he explicitly asked us to, but how have you been, Jay?
I got the Rona. It's not very fun. I was home. I've been unconscious the last 4 or 5 days.
Yikes.
Yeah, no, I've been like, I'm drained. I'll probably like randomly cough, speaking of which, and like, I'll like have sinus issues and headache, and just, I lost my sense of smell, but I still have my taste, so that's good.
This is a result of Jay and that infamous time on the podcast where we were talking about the Dream song. Mask song. You know, he actually removed the song.
Wait, what?
Yeah.
That's funny.
Took
Why?
It down. I don't know. There's re-uploads of it. I found out from like some YouTube video I was watching that like apparently
everyone's making fun of it because it's fucking awful.
Exactly.
You should have known before you made it. Things sounded like shit.
But yeah, this is all because Jay refused to understand what the meaning of the mask was.
Dream deleted it for that exact reason.
You've let him down, Jay.
Jay just couldn't understand.
I still don't know what that song was about. I never listened to it.
No, it's
not even kidding.
You don't have to.
But you guys are like, the mask scenario, and I was like, are we really talking about this? It's gonna get weird if we start talking about something like this that's touchy. And then you're like, oh, there was a song. I'm like, what the fuck are you talking about?
But yeah, besides that, we have myself. I said it last time, but I'm doing my Deathloop review. Not much else besides that. Life's been kind of boring, as usual.
If you want some inputs, I would happily help you with that, by the way. I'm not going to make my own video on it, but I could say some stuff if you want another opinion in it.
I'd put the other opinion in, but I'm like 20 minutes into editing. I've been trying to get video out for like 3 weeks now.
It's good. I was just offering, sorry.
Nah, don't worry about it. I've seriously considered like hiring help from like China or something. If I could afford people, yeah.
Point.
If I could afford someone to help me, I would gladly do it, but
same.
Yeah, besides that and all the catching up done, let's catch up with our guest, Avrona. Alex, how have you been?
They've been fine, very busy. Some big projects for the channel coming up. I'm working on this kind of like rebrand with like a new refresh of my channel's look, some more ambitious projects like a review of Windows 11, plus like uni started up again recently. And this time I'm actually on campus, so I can't just, you know, sit at home and listen to a lecture online every other day, and that's it. I have to travel into town and everything now, which is a pain.
Yeah, remote classes made literally YouTube so much easier to do for me.
They weren't helpful at all, but they did make YouTube
easier. They were terrible. I graduated from undergrad during the pandemic, so I don't feel qualified at all.
I mean, that was my first year, so it was definitely set the scene for the rest of my course.
Oh, yeah, that sucks. You didn't even, like, get to meet people in real life until this year.
Let's be honest, even if I did have the chance, I probably wouldn't socialize with too many people. I'm just not that kind of person.
But yeah, okay. now that we've caught up, let's just dive headfirst into the interview. So, Alex, would you like to introduce yourself, who you are, what you do? Just generally tell everything about yourself to the audience.
You want to know your social security number, your credit card numbers, everything.
Yeah, yeah, that too.
Sure, let me just dig it out. I have it here somewhere. No, I'm Alex of Rona, whatever. I've been on YouTube since August 2013. I do tech videos. And what else is there to me? I don't know. I'm a boring person.
Wait, so you brought up 2013. Yikes, man. That's longer. How old were you?
Probably a bit too young to be doing YouTube at a time. I was like, what, 12, 13 at a time?
Yeah, whoa, that's crazy. Like, I think I started my channel, my brother actually started my channel back in 2016, and then I took over in like 2017. But yeah, that's crazy. Like, what got you into all that?
Oh, so it's definitely a weird story. I know most YouTubers say that they had like a specific YouTuber they looked up to at the time, be like, you know, PewDiePie or Smosh or whoever was like popular at the time. For me, it was basically because I ran a blog, like this very, very amateur blog about this browser game for kids that was popular at the time. And I was part of this like larger blogging community. We all had our own blogs. It was great. It was so much fun. And I wanted to do something to make my personal blog stand out a bit more. So I thought, okay, how about I do videos as well? And then I thought I could just embed the videos directly into my posts, or I can make a YouTube channel, post them to YouTube instead, and then I could also be getting exposure from YouTube and have people also know about me and what I do from YouTube as well. So it's like a, you know, just more exposure for free, basically. So that's why I created my channel.
Yeah, so where was your blog based? Was it like one of those Google ones? Because I know a while back
it was in WordPress.
Okay, yeah. So
very amateur.
I know a lot of people do their podcasts on WordPress, so that's interesting. Because I remember blogs used to be the big thing back in the day. Mm. Like everyone had a blog. Like, yeah, I make it was like the old version of the influencer, like someone with a blog.
Yeah.
All right. So before we get into everything, let's delve a little bit into the type of content you've made in the past. So I've heard you used to be a Pokemon YouTuber, I want to say, right?
I've gone through so many things. So yeah. I started off making content around that browser game and other gaming stuff to go along with my blog, and also include some like more vlog style content, which was probably very cringy, seeing how I was only like, what, 14, 15 at a time. Then I went more into gaming Minecraft videos because that was kind of what was popular at the time. And I realized that, you know, that was around a time when the whole blogging community I was part of kind of died out, basically. And the game itself I was talking about was also just no one cared about it anymore. So I just had to jump ship to something more interesting, something people actually still care about, something I actually still care about. So I decided to do gaming stuff, primarily Minecraft. Then after that, didn't really do much for my channel for ages. I switched over to the Pokemon trading card game. It kind of just started off with me making a video of me opening like my very first booster pack ever, because I just got it for like super cheap at a car boot sale. And I saw that video did well, so I said, okay, maybe I'll do like a hybrid of Minecraft and Pokemon TCG content. Then I went to Pokemon TCG content. But then as time went on, I kind of realized that that isn't as good for my channel either. And so I decided to maybe dabble into tech. And I saw that that's probably like a very good and most importantly sustainable direction for my channel to take. One that's very scalable as well. So that's kind of what I decided to stick with.
Yeah, so it's interesting you mentioned tech, and I'll bring this up in a second when we start talking more. Well, when we get into the questions a little more, why did you like? You mentioned it was scalable and all that, but like, what explicitly drew you to tech? Because I know with tech, it's a lot of people consider it so saturated as a field, just because literally everyone and their mother, like, well, not watches like Linus Tech Tips and stuff. So it's I want to know what like drew you to that and what like you thought made that sustainable.
So there's two main reasons for that. The first one was it was an area I already had, like, definitely not the most knowledge in the world about, but it was an area I did have knowledge in. It was an area I was interested in. One of the few areas I feel like I'd have actually enough knowledge about it to actually make videos on a topic. And the second was that I really couldn't really think of too many other directions I could take my channel at that time. I saw that kind of Pokemon wasn't really working out, so I kind of just thought, okay, like, what is the left? What is something that's popular? Something I can imagine making videos on. Something that people actually watch. Something that is kind of searchable on YouTube. Something that will place into something that can be easy, like, SEO'd for. And, like, literally the only thing that met all that criteria was tech.
Actually, I was curious, since you brought up Pokemon again, I joked about this during our last technical problem, but I was curious, what is your favorite generation of Pokemon?
I didn't grow up with Pokemon. Literally, my first real experience with it was the Pokemon trading card game. So I have to say, I believe it's 7th generation, that's Sun and Moon.
That's controversial.
Because that's just the generation I really entered the community with. That's, you know, when I started making videos on Pokemon, the trading card game, it was just all the Sun and Moon expansions that were coming out. It was the Sun and Moon games, like dominating and everything. So, yeah.
But it's a valid reason. I mean, my favorites because
I had a sad childhood. Yeah. Yeah, I had a sad childhood. I didn't have Pokemon, so that's why it's not the latest, but, you know, the second latest generation for me.
Mm. Yeah, so I think with that, I'm going to use this kind of bridge into the history of the Averona channel, because I think this is very interesting. So actually, funnily enough, I learned about you because of I just managed to find a video about, like, I want to say, I guess, your controversies. I wouldn't really call them controversies, but, like, I actually didn't research much into it. I just found it and was linked to your channel. But what exactly, I think, you're known for, not to your actual audience, but to, like, randos on the internet, is I think you had, like, some involvement with some YouTuber a while back. Are you okay with, like, telling us about that?
So is that the Hopeless Beatrice?
Yeah, I think so. One.
I mean, there's been so many, like, story arcs to this at this point.
It's like an anime.
It really is. So the Hopeless Beatrice one is, oh boy, where do I start with that one? It's kind of hard for me to talk about it because I don't know too much of what was going on with her and why other YouTubers had issues with her. But I know, like, it ended up on, like, drama channels, like YouTube drama blogs. It was, like, a very, very big deal, I know, in, like, not it just in the, like, art commentary community, which is, like, where Peach's, which is the community that Peach is part of, but, like, even beyond that, it was a big deal. I have no idea, honestly, I have no idea what happened there. All I know is my kind of personal experiences with her and how that got dragged into all of it. So, basically, way before the things with Peach's really kind of kicked off, she made this kind of, like, story time video about me, and I made, like, a response video to that at a time, and that was kind of the end of the story. But then, like, maybe a year later, I was getting so many comments on that video out of nowhere saying, like, oh, I'm so sorry this happened to you. This shouldn't have happened. It's so nice to see that she's being brought to justice or whatever. I'm like, what is going on here? Why are people talking about this video all of a sudden? And then I went down a rabbit hole. Turned out she was involved in a whole bunch of drama. And so I decided to make, like, a follow-up video talking about, you know, my thoughts on the whole situation now with my very, like, limited information on what was going on in a broader Peach's drama. And that kind of led to my channel being kind of used as one of the examples of the a wider range of YouTubers that Peaches has wronged across the past like few months or years even. And kind of that's how my channel got dragged into all of it.
Interesting. Yeah, I really didn't know much about it myself. I just knew that it was like huge. Honestly speaking, after seeing like the responses on your videos, they were crazy. Some ranged from like, oh, I feel so bad for you, to others being like, you're shit, you make terrible content.
Oh my god.
Yeah, like I could not handle that type. I think the biggest video I ever made got like 70,000 views, and it was completely wrong. It was a video about Doom 2016 and the lore of the Doomslayer, and I got like I think 100 dislikes on that. The like ratio was still like 500 to 100, but like I was like distraught. I could not handle that kind of criticism on that level.
I mean, just for some context of how big this drama was, my average videos, my videos on average get a few hundred views, maybe like 1,000 if I'm lucky. That video I did just when the Peaches drama kicked off, like for real, got 80,000 views.
Yikes.
It's my second most viewed video on the channel. And other videos on the same topic got hundreds of thousands of views. It was a huge drama that I kind of brought my channel in.
You should have tried going on drama when we met Keemstar.
Oh, that would have been great.
That would have been so funny. But something I've seen a lot with the whole art community is... they get into a lot of drama. My YouTube and what I watch is very varied just because like I click whatever is in my recommended. I'm a stupid consumer. But I've had my time, I think it was a few years back, where like all my recommended was purely art community stuff. So like it's people like, Odd Ones Out, that one other guy, he was like 100,000 subs when I watched him, but he used to criticize art commentary channels. And I remember this whole, like, Peaches drama, but I didn't actually know all the people involved. I'm sure I watched the video with, like, your, like, little logo in it. And I'm just shocked as to how often they get into drama. Because, like, as a comparison, the community I came from and that Jay here is also still in, and I kind of participate in, is the Elder Scrolls community. And when we have, like, drama, right, it's all behind the scenes. There's not an ounce of the drama we have that goes, like, out. Like, I think in my time in the community, I have seen tons of people who just, like, are shitty, terrible, horrible people. But, like, no one makes an expose on them. But then you go to some community like the art community, and they're all, like, spewing about how, like, someone, like, wronged them and ruined their lives, or how someone's a pedophile.
Personally, it's just, I think it's because the art community, like, some of it is fabricated, and then some of it just leads to more people paying attention to this kind of stuff.
I also think it has a little bit to do with the fact that they're all like perpetually on Twitter, like their careers are based off it. And Twitter's an entire argument we could get into. We've had many conversations about the shithole that is Twitter. But
I feel like I'm not sure how much this is the case in the art commentary community, but I know in some communities where there's a lot of drama, there's almost this like unspoken gentleman's rule that is almost done despite the creators all kind of hating each other, whatever. They know that they're doing it just for views, and they kind of like to keep things going and kind of benefit each other. It's a weird mechanism, you know, just like starting the drama just so like every single person who's part of it, even if they hate each other, they know they all benefit from it in some way, and they're going to be attracting a lot of views from it. So even though they probably really would just want to, you know, end it, or just want to, you know, disprove that this YouTuber did something, or expose this YouTuber, they just want this to go on for as long as possible. And it's just like, I feel it's this weird agreement between them, unspoken agreement, that they just want to keep things going.
What I was just saying earlier, where it was like, a lot of it's just not fabricated, this is a bad word, but they seek this out because they know it sells.
Basically. Yeah, they like synthetically escalated. I'm not sure if that's a good way of describing it, but yeah, they try to make it as big as possible.
Interesting.
Because they know it's going to be profitable for them.
Do you think it's been profitable for you?
Oh, totally. I'm not even going to try and like hide it. I mean, it took my channel from around 1,000 something views to over 4,000 in a matter of weeks, if not days, when it was all going on. And the month of December of 2020, was it 2020 or 2019? 2020, I had more views in that 1 month. It was my highest viewed month ever. It was like AdSense wise, it was my best month ever, subscriber wise, likewise. Like, it was insane. Now, I'm not trying to say that, you know, it was like the only reason I was doing it. Of course not. And I did feel like I wanted to have my say. I wanted to tell my part of the story. But like, you know, let's not pretend that people didn't benefit from it, no matter like how right or how wrong they are. Everyone benefited from that drama.
Yeah. It's really interesting that all that happened to you. Like, I would, like I said, it would be impossible for me to get around that much like criticism and drama. But all right, now that we've discussed a little bit of the history, I'll ask you one more question about this in a bit. But how do you go about making your videos? I know you've been very big about talking about like all the effort you put into the channel. So where does it all start and how does it all get to the end product?
So when you make... So with my schedule of 7 videos a week, I try to be very efficient with how I set everything out. And actually, with most of my videos, they get done in usually the same day. They get shot, edited, and uploaded in the same day. And then planning them out usually takes about 2 days, I'd want to say. And when I'm trying to think of what to make videos on, I mean, it's... The main source is just, well, other tech news outlets. It's seeing what crazy products are being announced. It's about what the big companies are doing, what the smaller companies are doing that maybe not many people are heard of, or, you know, things that maybe bigger YouTubers haven't really talked about. That's like my opportunity to maybe make my own video about it instead that people can see. So when I plan what kind of videos I make, it usually just involves going to websites that talk about tech, reading up on what the top articles are, then I plan a video, and then straight to recording, editing, uploading, usually within the same day. With bigger projects, it usually takes a bit longer.
I'm actually curious, how do you manage to like edit all that in the day? Is it just like the fact that like your planning is incredible? Because I think you heard me earlier, but like, I've been working on a review for like the last 3 weeks, and I've just gotten to the final editing phase now.
I don't want to say that my planning is like amazing, but one thing is I also try to keep my videos very brief, because just so to make sure that people kind of watch as much of it as possible, just keep it nice and fast and snappy. So that means that the final edit is usually, I try to keep my videos around like 4 to 6 minutes maximum.
Mm.
So that helps. There's also the fact that most of it is usually just a roll, unless it's like a review. Reviews are a completely different story. Those take way longer, usually like 2 days of editing, lots of B-roll, lots of shooting, lots of everything. But most of the videos, if it's just me talking, then just a transition and an image of what I'm talking about, then back to me, then like another transition to something else related to what I'm talking about, that just doesn't really take that long that much time. The most like time, the thing that takes the most amount of time is just cutting out all the times I just mess up.
Oh, so it's not scripted?
It's, I want to say it's like semi.
Oh, so you have like I've done it before. You just have like a little Word document with bullet points, right?
Yeah, basically.
Yeah, that's, I'm honestly I don't know how you do it. Like 7 videos a week. Like, holy shit, man. What the fuck? How do you do it? That is insane. Do you ever like feel like burnout? Because I know that happens with pretty much every YouTuber in existence.
I definitely feel tired at the end of it, but I definitely never felt like proper burnout set in. I don't know. It's weird. I always had like the opinion that with burnout, I feel like I can just tell myself, hey, this needs to be done. Don't just, you know, don't lie in bed or sit at your PC doing nothing. If something has to be done, do it. There's just like no excuse for it. I feel like I'm one of a person that can force myself to do something in those kind of situations. So it's not something I'm worried about. Who knows, maybe after like another 5 years or however much, I will just feel like a wreck. But I'm not there just yet.
Well, that's great. I know with myself, like, I can do that. It's just, if, like, I miss one upload really badly, like, I'm just like, damn, man, I don't know if I can do this anymore, but I haven't gotten there yet. We've been at this for 2 months since my last hiatus, so hopefully it keeps going.
Inside creatively-wise.
But, yeah, so recently your channel has gotten, I wouldn't say a lot, but you tend to get criticism from that Peaches era, especially because now that, from what I saw, like I was mentioning earlier, like people are saying, oh, you only have subscribers because you're Pity subscribed to, right? So what I'm wondering about that is, do you, like, I know recently we actually had a YouTuber on that made like a video about you, Zero No Zero. This is actually a few months back, I want to say. But what are your answers to those criticisms? Because I do want to give you a platform to kind of just like explain how you feel about all this stuff.
Oh boy, where do I start with that? That could be like a whole 2-hour podcast in its own manner, but if the last 2 years have shown us anything, it's that people are bored by the status quo, and people get very easily taken in by misinformation, and that people also love a good bandwagon. And we've seen it in a lot of IRL situations, which I probably don't have to even talk about. People probably know what I'm talking about. And I feel like when you piece all that together with the additional freedom and anonymity and the lack of consequences of the internet, and you get the perfect recipe for a real kind of mob rule. And I feel like that is what's been kind of happening with my channel. People, like I said, people do not like the status quo. People like to have something to distract them, something they can like rally against, and something that allows them to feel morally superior, or at least makes them feel like they are in the right, as a nice little distraction in life. I know there's a lot more to it than that, and everyone has kind of, a lot of people are just jumping in for the bandwagon. Other people may have their own reason for thinking different things about me. But at the end of the day, it is just a cycle of, yeah, it's a cycle of very small, unimportant stuff being completely blown out of proportion, and kind of, yeah, a bandwagon taking place, basically. And yeah, I guess that's the best way I could probably describe it.
Yeah, so I think, and I really do want to put this out there, because I've looked at your content, right? And realistically speaking, I think the stuff you're criticized about in terms of like the hits and the misses and all that is the fact that based on your schedule, right, the way you talk about it, it really just seems that any mistakes you make are 100% based off your time limit, from what I understand and what I've seen. Speaking 100% honestly, I think your content is like, for tech stuff, is perfectly good. There's nothing like terrible about it. It's not as though it's low budget. It's not as though it's like some guy talking into a shitty mic about like his opinions on Windows 11 or some shit, right? It's pretty well put together, I'd say. I think the one video that was criticized by one of our guests, Zero, was, I think it was a video on motion control you were doing, and you were like playing something. Like, I guess that intro, I mean, okay. Realistically speaking, the intro wasn't the best, but the content of the video was good. I think, like you're saying, the criticisms for your channel are more than likely just a result of the whole Peaches drama, alongside the fact that some people think that they're entitled to dislike you for the fact that you were embroiled in drama and
what? You're all gay. You're all very gay.
It's him! It's him! Sorry about interrupting this the interview, but this is Cam.
This is one hell of an interruption.
This is Cam. He used to be one of the old...
The legend has arrived.
He used to be one of the old hosts on the podcast. Cam, hi. How you doing, Cam?
What's up, bitches?
How's life been, Cam?
I don't know. I'm pretty drunk right now.
Oh, my God.
I'm trying to go to sleep because I gotta go to work at like 9:30, and I just happen to wake up from my piss and say, "Hey, look, these fuckers are doing their thing."
Well, thank you for coming on, Cam. This has been an honor.
I would have been on yesterday if you would have kept it yesterday.
Well, I'm sorry. I was playing League of Legends. Yes, you can make fun of me.
I didn't know you were gay.
All right, Cam, thank you very much. This will be like the best part of the podcast.
Honestly, I love you guys. I just hopped in to say hi and keep me updated when the next one is, and I'll definitely pop in.
Roger that, Captain.
All right, later, guys.
Yep, see ya.
See ya.
How do I get out of this? Oh, wait, here it is. Bye.
Bye.
Bye. Well, that was definitely interesting.
Yeah, that's Cam. He's the resident. He's the resident. We'll just leave it at that.
Yeah, he comes and goes.
He just is deep conversation about like content and what you make, and suddenly, just out of nowhere, this in the red level audio. What's up, fuckers? It's just like, okay.
Yeah. Okay. So to kind of get us back on track, where was I? Yeah, so I think in general, just the way that people look at your content, in my opinion, purely, and based off me looking at your content, and then obviously looking at the content of the people on the channels that have criticized you, I think, if anything, worst case scenario, the people's content is comparable to yours, like, in terms of quality. I legitimately think, like you said, it's a bandwagon at this point, and the best thing you can do is what you're doing right now, which is just putting your head down and working at it.
A while back, I still kind of tried to respond to it, but there was just so much of it, and I just felt like I was repeating myself, but people just still refused to listen. It just felt like I was going in circles. It felt like I was literally talking to a wall, and even though those videos were guaranteed to make... to generate quite a few views, I was just like, yeah, no, this is just not worth it. I'm just tired of all of this.
Well, it's also important to note that, like, purely embroiling yourself in drama eternally can also be, like, the death of a channel. Like, let's look at something like a prime example for this, Trisha Paytas. I don't know if anyone follows her or even knows anything about her, but I don't know what she started out as. All I know is that she is in the drama news all the time, and that's all she's ever in the news for, because her channel is dead without drama. And realistically speaking, that stuff is not sustainable mentally. Let's just be honest. Like, if you've ever seen anything she posts on Twitter, she's having mental breakdowns like every other day. So it's a good thing that you've kind of taken a step back from that. But yeah, with that done, I think we can start wrapping up this interview. What do you think is... you mentioned this a little at the beginning. What is the future of the Averona channel? You kind of mentioned a sort of visual rework, some bigger projects. Anything else you could like tell us about?
A big focus of my channel for the past like a year, I want to say, it was just try to make it as professional as I can and just make it seem like this proper tech news outlet. Even if, you know, I don't have the views for one, I don't have the subscribers for one, I just want to have the appearance of this very not proper professional tech news outlet. And I want people to look at my channel and I want them to see the content first and the kind of subscriber count and view count later. Because I want it to be very obvious that my subscriber count and view count are not a representation of the quality of my content. I want to make it as clear as possible that this channel is a way bigger deal than that. It's a way bigger project. It's just bigger in every single aspect than our view count and sub count would lead you to believe. And it's been something I've been trying to kind of compensate for the fact that my channel has been so small. It's been something I've been working on for ages, but even more so as in the past year, and I continue to do so. Going in the future, I'm planning to invest even more into the channel. I think I have like something like $6,000 lined up to be put into like new equipment, new like everything for the next like couple of months. I'm hoping to bring on like maybe people to help out. I'm hoping to experiment with some new video formats. I'm hoping to start doing some more ambitious projects and working with tech brands more as my channel grows. The very annoying thing is that I really like planning ahead of my channel. I have so many great projects planned. Projects that I know I would enjoy working on a lot more than the kind of stuff I'm doing now. And projects I know that my audience would also enjoy a lot more than the stuff I'm doing now. But it's all limited by how fast or how slow my channel actually grows in the end. And that is probably like the most infuriating part of YouTube for me. Because I have very, very big plans for my channel. It's just now that painful, painful wait until I can actually execute them. And I'm going to assume that you guys are probably like the same in a way. I'm not sure like how much you like have planned ahead your kind of YouTube channels, but I just really like kind of thinking of what I want to do in the future. And it's just kind of having to put it aside until the channel grows a bit more. But hopefully when it does, I'm going to have some really awesome stuff lined up. And that's about it.
I guess in that regard, do you think YouTube will ever be like a career for you, or are you just planning to have it always as like a side gig?
I have no idea, because it is impossible to predict.
Yeah, that's true. It's some people like don't even expect their channels to take off.
I would love it. It would be, I think, an amazing career or just something in that direction, because it's just an area I have experience in now. And yeah, like for better or worse, it's just kind of an area of expertise I aligned myself with that's just probably going to just stick with me for life. So, you know, I could have been a doctor, but I have, you know, skills in making videos instead. So just kind of have to play to my strengths in that regard then.
All right. So, like I said, wrapping the interview up, is there anything else that like interests you besides just YouTube, maybe tech, I guess?
Like I said, I'm a very boring person. There really isn't too much to me other than what I talk about on the channel. I like tech. I make YouTube videos. I play video games.
Yeah. All right. So I won't delve too much in the IRL stuff, just because you kind of did give us some stuff in your introduction there. But anything else you want to shout out before I pass it off to the other hosts? Ask any questions they have?
Nope. Take it away.
All right. Anyone got any questions to Alex here?
No, I'm good.
No.
But yeah, with that, we can move on. We don't have anything for general internet stuff and news, but I'll let Matt take away the next part, which is whatever we want to talk about. And Matt.
We'll go with yours. Apparently, the chip shortage, it got worse, even though I thought it was dying down.
Yeah, so interesting that it's amazing you brought that up, Matt, that we thought it was getting better, but no, it's not getting better, but it might be getting better. I don't know. I've heard conflicting reports. The reason I put it's getting worse is because I recently saw a tech-linked video from Linus Tech Tips about how apparently, it's common knowledge that, I hope it's common knowledge that pretty much all our manufacturing is in China. So it includes chips, plastics, whatever the fuck you want to talk about. But every last bit of our production comes from China. And what China recently did, they've been making huge strides to like re-communize, I guess, their country. The first thing I'd say recently that we saw in it was the whole retaking of Hong Kong and how basically Hong Kong, it's basically just mainland China now at this point with slightly more freedoms. Another thing we saw was the whole video game thing where kids are like forced to register like their social security numbers or whatever the hell they have in China and like have like limited play time of video games per week and they can only play on weekends. So huge impacts to the markets there. And then the most recent thing, which is why a lot of people were concerned about the chip shortage, is China has cut off power to like entire regions where these factories are. So basically hundreds of factories are just suddenly not producing chips anymore. And if you know how bad the chip shortage is, I was actually going to make a joke about this when Alex here was mentioning getting sponsorships about passing me a GPU. But like, there's absolutely no way that this could like benefit the chip shortage. I know, because I also saw another article about Lisa Su, the president of AMD, saying something like, oh, the chip shortage is going to get better. This is just normal. I mean, obviously, this one wasn't caused by normal highs and lows, but it's going to get better by 2022. And I do not believe her in the slightest. She's scared, honestly,
because my job kind of depends on that. So I actually have recently had my hours cut because of that. So it's got me a little concerned. I can definitely feel the immediate impact of it.
And it really sucks that China did this too, because I don't know why they would do it. Maybe they're like, I honestly can't figure out like a potential like motive for this. Like, why would you shut down all this power to these certain regions that have these factories when it's just gonna like stop chips from being manufactured? And then, like I was saying, Lisa Su was like, yeah, we have a bunch of new fabs being made in like the next 18 months, so we'll have like a bunch of new fabs and the chip shortage will end. But I'll make my prediction right now. It'll get better, but it will not end for like another 2 years.
Probably. I
want to ask our resident tech YouTuber here, what are your opinions on the chip shortage?
I mean, the cryptocurrency boom is kind of slowly going away. Graphics cards are still impossible to buy, though. And honestly, the difficult thing to predict now is how well will companies like AMD and NVIDIA and Intel be prepared for the launches of their next products and how much fab capacity they would have for the upcoming new CPUs and GPUs, whatever, because the current generation is a lost cause, let's be honest. And many people are just kind of waiting out for the next one. So will it just be like a, will the people who couldn't buy their new hardware this time around, are they just going to flood to the next generation of stuff and are we going to have shortages of that instead? And will those companies be able to recover by then, or are they basically just going to be divvying up their fab capacity too much between too many different products?
I think it's definitely important for us moving forward. And this is just my uneducated opinion on this shit, but we really got to stop like supporting China and their weird business shit they've got going on. And that's not me being weird. It's just China's a terrible country with a terrible government.
Get the headline ready, Matt. We have another.
Well, you're literally saying people are shutting down.
Yeah, they are. They're terrible.
Like, they're terrible people. And it's like, why are we supporting these guys?
The someone's going to get blackbagged by the CCP.
All right, I'll see you later.
Already getting rid of my job.
Bye, Jay.
Jay's slowly becoming the Joker.
Yeah.
When you wake up in a Chinese camp, Jay, let us know.
I'm already a dead man.
Yeah. I mean, this podcast has had a history of criticizing China, but don't worry about it. We'll all disappear at some point in our 20s, right?
Pretty much. Yep. I'm expecting it.
All right, yeah, so moving on. Matt, you want to talk about your thing?
Yes, I would love to. Did everyone watch the Nintendo Direct?
I don't think you have to watch the Direct to know what you're talking about. It's all over the internet.
Tell the audience anyways.
Well, if you haven't seen it, they're making a Mario movie coming out next year. And Mario is being voiced by none other than Chris Pratt. He's so cool.
I can't believe they said that. It was like,
funny man Jack Black is also going to be there.
I'm more interested in Charlie Day as Luigi.
I don't know. When I watched it live, I'm not really a big Nintendo guy, but me and my roommate were kind of like, oh, fuck it. Why not? Let's watch it. And then when Chris Pratt popped up on the screen, I lost it. But then what really got me was Seth Rogen Donkey Kong.
Yeah.
I think that was my favorite, and still is.
I mean, jokes aside, no matter how many people maybe talk about how bad of a choice it may be, the second they said that Mario is being voiced by Chris Pratt, they basically solidified that this movie is going to make mad returns.
Oh, yeah, for sure. I'm seeing it opening night.
Yeah, so am I.
I kind of have to.
And the best part is that it's being made by Illumination. So
Yeah.
It's like Disney, no, not Disney, Nintendo went out of their way to go and find the studio that makes like the most like, I really feel like they're trying to make this into like a phenomenon with like memes, because there's no way that something made by Illumination isn't going to seep into like the popular culture. Yeah.
Yeah.
Imagine if there's like a Minions cameo.
You already know. Yeah, you already know now.
Mario in the
you know, part of me, this all started happening around the time I like got sick, and I've been just secretly hoping this was all a fever dream.
I was about to say,
I really hope I just wake up randomly. It's like, Jake, the virus is over, and also Mario is being voiced by actual Mario voice actor.
No, the weirdest part is they have the actual.
He's a cameo.
Yeah, he's in the movie.
No, but he's not just a cameo. He's several cameos.
Yeah, he's voicing so many characters, but he's not allowed to voice Mario. We're going to have like a shitty Chris Pratt impersonation.
The reason why is because he's not marketable for major audiences who don't know who Mario is voiced by.
But he's such a recognizable voice. He voiced like Parthenon.
Yeah, but,
he voiced like...
But still, you have to kind of think, when you're walking in the mall... and you see a poster for the Mario movie, and you see Chris Pratt's name, people are going to be like, oh, Funny Man Jack Black and Funny Man Chris Pratt are in the Mario movie. I like them both. I'll go see it. And then you see, if they did that with the guy who really voices Mario, then people are going to be like, oh, who the fuck is that? So it's really all about... It wasn't so much of a... like, hey, fuck you, guy. It was more of a... you're not as marketable as a famous person such as Chris Pratt.
Mm-hmm. That's basically an FU, though. That dude is such a phenomenal voice actor and deserves more credit.
No, for sure. But like, I think a bigger fuck you was like him being like blatantly like kicked out of the project.
Oh yeah, like what happened to Wood's voice actor?
Yeah.
But yeah, okay. So Jay, you want to talk about what you want to talk about?
Let's hope I don't cough 20 times while I'm explaining this. I've been playing Enderal lately. And if you don't know what that is, if you know me, I love Skyrim. Enderal is a conversion mod for Skyrim that basically makes an entirely new game out of the Skyrim engine. And a lot of the code and everything that was used to make it is used to make this new game with a new setting, with a new narrative. And it's a great mod because now on Steam, you can download it separately. You don't have to mod your Skyrim. You can just go to Steam, and as long as you own the version of Skyrim that you're trying to get that version of Enderal for, you could just have an entirely separate application dedicated to this game, which is crazy. And I've been playing it the last, I believe, 3 days. And I played it before, like a year or two ago, on the Legendary edition of Skyrim engine. There's a Legendary edition, there's a Special edition, and they just recently, I believe a couple months ago, released a Special edition as a separate download that you can get on Steam, and it's a lot more stable. So if you want to try out something and you have, you know, Skyrim Legendary or Special edition, you can just go to Steam and download it. It's a really fun open world fantasy game with a lot of unique, interesting characters, all of it's voice acted, and I've been really enjoying it. I just wanted to talk about it for a little bit.
Yeah, how far have you gotten into it?
I have gotten sidetracked in the first area of the Sun Coast, I think. And it's really cool. I think I've leveled up like 6 times. And I've just been exploring, doing bounties, a bunch of creatures, learning new spells. pretty crazy.
I played it on launch. Like, I think when did the year? I think the original released in 2015. I want to say.
Yeah, because they were working on the thing for Legendary Edition, and Special Edition was launched, and they're like, "We'll get to that eventually."
Yeah, I was blown away at the time. It was amazing. Like, I really feel like the Skyrim engine kind of brought them down, because that game, it is a game, because it's got no relation to Skyrim outside of, like, assets, I'd say, in terms of, like, models and textures and the engine, I guess. But honestly, so many aspects of that game, especially, like, the cinematics that they did, like, all yes. I guess, like, the scripted things, are miles above the quality of Skyrim. And I was frankly, like, amazed. The only gripe I really had with the game was the fact that, and I have this gripe with every single Skyrim mod in existence, or, like, complete conversion, is the UI fucking sucks. Please, I don't know how you do it. Please, if you're gonna make, like, a total conversion mod, find a way to, like, actually get rid of Skyrim's UI. I know Enderal tried it with, like, their own custom thing, but in the end, it was just Skyrim's UI. It was, like, it didn't feel like another game's UI to me, at least. And I feel like
the way they modified it, it's like they use Sky UI for a lot of it, which is really nice.
Yeah, but in the end, it still got, like, that. I'm pretty sure it's still, like, the black and silver, right? The colors for it, yeah. I really feel like, because I think the big one that stands out to me is Skywind with their UI, and their UI is literally just a skin. So that's like the equivalent to what this was, but with less functionality. And I really wish they would put more effort into that when they're already putting so much into, like, every other aspect of the game. But
I can understand. That's a pretty valid criticism on my point, or my book.
Yeah. Alex, do you have anything you want to talk about, or?
Honestly, not really. It's your show. You know what's,
All right, if that's what you want, like, to do.
Yeah, you probably know what like, your viewers want to hear about.
We can move on to the best part of the podcast that everyone loves and is 100% from the community, the lightning round.
Yay, lightning round.
All right, question number one. You guys ready for this?
Yep.
CDPR, again.
Ha ha ha. Ha 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 ha. Yeah.
All right, number two.
Ha 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 ha.
Stadia supports phones as controllers.
That's actually kind of, I mean, like, this is just me being stupid, but I actually kind of think that's kind of cool, like, on a surface level.
But why would they add this after how long, when there's, like, 1,000 concurrent players on Stadia?
Yeah, true. But I mean, the concept of just being able to use your phone as a controller is kind of interesting. I kind of wish something more, you know, relevant was using it, but still.
Yeah.
I mean, given the fact that, like, no one can get a next-gen console or, like, a PC parts, is, like, the perfect time for Stadia to take off. They just need a few more features like that to attract people. So, like, it's just another feature. So hopefully with some extra stuff, they're going to finally be relevant soon.
I don't think they'll ever be relevant. I think, like all Google products, Stadia is going to die so other better products can rise.
I mean, it's been alive for, like, what, 2 years now? It's still alive somehow. Really?
It's on, like, a drip feed, though. Like, the only big games that I've ever heard people talk about on it are, like, ESO and Destiny 2.
There.
And I understand those. Still alive. Yeah, I understand those audiences are big. It's just, I don't think they're enough to sustain Stadia, which apparently had top of the line computer components in each fucking server rack. And it's like, no, you guys are literally just running last gen hardware. You just have a lot of it. But yeah. Anyways, question three.
This is the second picture. I can't even make out what that is.
I don't know who broke it, but that's Tim the Tat Man.
Oh, I just see his beard and half his face.
The roster grows.
We have a new person who enters the fray. Famous YouTuber Jacksepticeye.
Who will win?
Jacksepticeye, Tim the Tat Man, or Dream?
I really wish. can't even make out Tim the Tapman. No,
Tim the Tapman's broken beyond repair at this point.
I know.
I'm surprised how Dream has survived.
Dream,
but like Tim the Tapman, I we can't fix him. He's broken. He's a broken man. But Dream still stands tall.
But now, innocence, incarnate.
But now it's all up to you, Jacksepticeye. Will you stop Dream's tyranny?
This poor man. He's like, I'm just here.
With that, we can bring the podcast to an end. Thanks, Alex, for coming down. Very interesting learning about your experiences on YouTube. And like, honestly, great interview. Loved it. Do you have anything you want to shout out, though, before we end the podcast?
I mean, I just want to say thanks so much for having me on. It was a blast. It was really fun. And yeah, I have a Patreon. It's just Avrana. Check it out. Even $1 a month goes a long way into my channel. And I used to make way better videos, and also videos on way more interesting topics. And also just, you know, if you're ever unsure of what one random niche piece of technology does, then who knows, maybe I have a video on my channel. Give it a go. See if I do. And again, thank you so much for having me on.
So thank you once again for coming down. I'll have everything in the description as usual. And thanks for watching. We'll see you all around. Bye.
Bye, guys. Bye. Thank you, Corona.